Despite the growth of the financial services sector in many African countries, financial inclusion remains high, particularly among African women. Joining me now to talk about that, talking about financial inclusion, or exclusion as it were, on the African continent, particularly here in Nigeria, is Mary Ellen Iskaderian. She's the CEO of Women's World Banking on Women Wars Banking. Thank you so much, Mary Ellen, for being here.
Thank you.
Now, it's quite ironic because when you think about the fact that in the last 3-4 years, especially since the financial crisis, a lot of money, of course, hedge funds or managers looking for the best returns, a lot of money, a lot of capital has come down into Africa. So many African economies have been forced to perhaps develop faster their financial services sector. But it would seem that, a lot of focus has been more on the formal sector than in the informal, and we have so many people, especially adults, both male and female, excluded from the financial services sector. Just your thoughts on that.
Well, I think the trends that you mentioned actually have led to a much greater focus on the fact that across Africa, roughly 70% of the financial transactions that take place are taking place in the informal sector. And so you have some very far-sighted regulators, including the Central Bank of Nigeria, we believe, who've really recognized that the opportunity really is with that 70% of the excluded population. And I think here in Nigeria, you've really seen a renewed focus on financial inclusion as a real imperative for the financial sector. There's been some really excellent efforts in the regulatory environment to really give banks that push to reach out to that population. Here in Nigeria, there are about 56 million people who are excluded from the formal financial sector. 27 million of them are women. And
huge numbers.
Exactly.
Okay, so well, let's talk about women. I mean, it's often said that, you know, if you want to develop an economy, just empower the women financially, especially perhaps even the women in the rural areas. Well, they are the ones that take care of the family. They take care of the family income. They look after the welfare of the children and perhaps even the husband. So, you know, empowering them financially, you know, is key for the economy. But that hasn't particularly been the case in the last, at least since we can remember. But why do you think that has been the case, even though we're now seeing some focus on that now, you know, financial regulators trying to change that?
Well, we see, and it's really a totally global phenomenon, that when women have access to finance in their own names and have some discretion over how that money is spent, they tend to spend their money on things like the financial education of their kids, the health care of their whole families, their housing, their nutrition. So things that really can have a tremendous impact in leading that family to a better life and potentially out of poverty. And so the impact on a financial empowerment of women can be that much greater. I hesitate to say, but it is often true, that much greater than of men, because men are just generally far less likely to make those kinds of community and household investments than women are.
Well, I think that has been proven. At least I've seen one or two reports giving credence to that. Well, let's talk about your network, Women's World Banking. You have you're partnered with a network of 39 leading microfinance institutions in 28 countries. Now, let's focus on Africa. Some of the countries that you've partnered with, or where you are: Ghana, Gambia, Kenya, and Uganda. But I don't see Nigeria on that list. And why is that?
Well, we've made a really conscious effort in the last few years to expand our footprint. And you really, as you say, you can't be attempting to work on financial inclusion issues and not be in Nigeria. But we wanted to make sure we were working with institutions that really had the capacity to have outreach and to make an impact. And we felt strongly that a commercial bank, and a commercial bank willing to make the appropriate investments into moving down into that underbanked sector, was the way to go. And so we were absolutely delighted that Diamond Bank here in Nigeria was interested in partnering with us. And we've been rolling out these last 4 months a pilot product that is a savings product specifically targeted to un and underbanked people here in Nigeria, with as always with Women's World Banking, a particular focus on unbanked women.
I know you said that for other countries, you're partnering with the commercial banks in this country, so that will be the case with Nigeria, not the central bank, the commercial banks. Yeah. Now, tell us how you've been able to assure financial institutions, perhaps the microfinance banks, to move beyond traditional microfinance, perhaps instruments, into providing better safety nets for women.
Well, I think that speaks directly to our move into working with commercial banks, because we feel very strongly that in order to have full financial inclusion, full financial empowerment, people need more than just the microcredit that we think of as the traditional product of microfinance institutions. They need savings products. They need insurance products. They need both the opportunity for prosperity, but they need that safety net and security as well. And In many instances, and particularly here in Africa, we've seen that it's commercial banks that have the capacity, the technology, the platform, the human resource capability to offer that broader suite of services.
Now, for some of these African countries, even here in Nigeria, one major problem is perhaps distance to many of these financial institutions. And you've talked about, trying to upgrade on the financial products. But some of them might be that education, literacy, challenge, barrier. Yes, a woman in the rural area, she wants to have a savings account, she wants to have access to loans, but she can't read. There's nothing about technology. So how are you going to break those barriers?
Great question. Financial education is at the heart of every product that we're involved in. And exactly as you say, making the financial education tools fully understandable in whatever language, and for those who may not be fully literate, those who may not be fully numerate. So we really adapt the education to the need. We've just completed a very exciting project in Kenya, where we've woven financial education messages into a very popular nightly drama or weekly nighttime drama called Makutana Junction. It reaches 8 million viewers in Kenya, and we've had 8 weeks of very well-phrased, well-told stories that involve financial education. And then 3 Kenyan banks have been engaged in reaching out to a broader range of clients and customers, capitalizing on those messages from the television show. We've had members of the cast going to the branches and really seeing the clients saying that they are coming to the bank, opening accounts, reactivating accounts because they've seen the television show.
For you, what gives you fulfillment? We haven't talked about the numbers, perhaps we'll get to that, but empowering women and showing that they have access to finance, perhaps not just women, having people have basically just access to finance. For you, what has been the biggest fulfillment, that thing that's made you go, oh yes, we're doing, happy about this?
Well, I think it's this notion of providing multiple products, and I think as we've gotten into working with financial institutions that can offer savings, that's been a tremendous game changer for those of us who are working to provide financial services to the base of the pyramid. Because as you noted, people are saving and they want a safe place to keep their money. And so that can be a great link to the formal financial sector. And once you've made that entry into the financial sector, you can be counted, you have access to other sorts of products, other sorts of access more generally to capital. So it can be a tremendous opening to a population that was previously excluded.
Okay, I assume you talked to some of the women. Is that what they tell you in terms of perhaps their priority, in terms of what they need the most, second on their list of in terms of financial access to financial services? Is it savings accounts? Is it just access to loans?
I think those are the two things, access to loans and to savings accounts, but they are saving. I mean, they're doing so in informal ways, but they really value the security, the confidentiality, being able to keep what they're saving and why they're saving to themselves, and the convenience. Bringing the bank to the client is a hallmark of the successful products that are reaching this population. And so we hear from women that if that can be included, that's a huge priority.
Now, do you get a sense, as you go from country to country, particularly here in Africa, you've talked to Diamond Bank here in Nigeria, do you get a sense of a commitment on their part to bring all that cash, or at least empower those in the informal sector to come be part of the formal sector? Do you get a sense, not just perhaps the banks themselves, perhaps the regulators themselves, the African governments?
Oh, I think absolutely. I think you've really started to see a real shift that regulators are, of course, always concerned about systemic risk and wanting to protect the financial sector, but recognizing that huge percentage of financial transactions taking place outside the formal sector are every bit as important as those that are immediately under regulation. So we've seen a real commitment on the part of regulators, and as I say, that sort of trickled down to banks like Diamond.